God and Alcoholics Anonymous, also that I stand up here tonight. Probably shouldn't be here. I do have a sponsor. He has a sponsor. This is my home group. Been my home group now for 6 or 9 months. Don't know the exact date. I'm very fortunate to wound up here. While it's prodding me along to get here, I joined another group first, and I came up here, and I'm very, very grateful for that. So I guess I'll dive right in because I'm super nervous. I'm glad a lot of you sat in the back because I can't see that far. I need glasses. So your faces are blurry. That's good. I can see you. So I guess I always start my story with the AA history in my family. My dad got sober in 1984, and I was born 3 years later. So he met my mother she was a nurse at Pioneers Treatment Center at Moore Regional Hospital. I am from here, born at Moore Regional, and she was a nurse. She's about 12 years younger. And he was coming into Alcoholics Anonymous with nothing but the clothes on his back, and they hit it off, and I come along 3 years later. He went to Bethesda in 84, I think it was. AJ knowed him well. He went down there, stayed there for 18 months until they married. And they married, I came along, and the problems started around that time. I'd say they divorced when I was 3, and it was a nasty divorce. Basically my mom tried to keep me from my dad, and I didn't see him for 3 years. And ended up, he had a lot of support in Alcoholics Anonymous. There was a lot of false accusations against him. It was a really nasty situation. Basically I was the weapon. And I guess that's where the feelings of inadequacy and fears and things like that cropped up as a young kid. You hear a lot of people say they weren't born an alcoholic. I do believe that I could have possibly got the genetics from my father because they come out at a young age and very strong. They divorced, and I went and stayed with my mom. We bounced around. He hired a private detective to keep an eye on his son. And so her seeing this man, basically stalking, this is what his job was, to keep an eye that we wouldn't leave state or, whatever. He wanted to keep an eye on where his son was. There was a lot of fear of somebody trying to harm me as a child. I'd always come in the house. We'd have to check the crawl space, check under the beds, things like that. Mom kept a pistol. So that, growing up, instilled a lot of fear in me. My little brother come along, and mom got engaged to him. He's 7 years younger than I am, and his father was kind of mean. I don't know what his issues was. She didn't stay with him, but my dad did what he was supposed to do in Alcoholics Anonymous. He listened to people. He had a great sponsor. He ended up getting custody of me. It all come out in court that he was the more suitable parent, and he got custody. So I went to live with him at 6 years old. And I started school down here at Southern Pines Elementary School. And I guess he started doing electrical work when he'd been doing it for years, but he really got into his career when he got sober. And at this time, he'd become an electrical contractor. And so he was starting his life out at that. And I guess with all the stuff that was going on, basically, we moved into a single-wide mobile home in a mobile home park, and it was a large diversity of people there, a lot of different cultures and whatnot, and we all fit in really well. We're mean, we're bullies, and I guess we all had our issues, and I fit right in with that crowd. And some of their parents, it's funny how, my dad being a sober member, Alcoholics Anonymous, starting a career as an electrical contractor, I didn't look up to him. I looked up to my best friend, whose dad sold narcotics to get his eyes fixed. He was born cross-eyed, and that was like, my idol for some reason. I can't explain why. I was fascinated. Well, I was fascinated with the teenagers that were renting mobile homes in that part that were partying and had motorcycles and things like that. That fascinated me. The lifestyle my dad lived did not fascinate me. I went to a lot of meetings. I was down at the Wilder Building as a kid. It was all old people back then. Now it was a lot of young people. It was all old people, nice fancy rides. It was wild. It was like some kind of weird clubhouse that he went to, And I'd be outside, and those trees out there has got the perfect grenades you can throw as a kid, climbing those trees or whatnot. Really didn't understand AA. He met a woman, I was probably 9 years old, 3 years later, and married her. She was an Alcoholics Anonymous. She'd been sober for 3 years. And she had Ashley was 14, and her son Casey was 16. So I had step siblings. They bought a house in Highland Hills, and we moved in together. And around this time, When I was younger, I automatically, my dad used to keep cash on him. This is before we had debit cards and whatnot. He only used a checkbook to pay bills. He kept $100 bills, and I was fascinated with stealing them. He didn't have any way to spend them or anything. And he'd look his wallet, and he'd see some missing. He'd say, "Where's my money?" And he'd punish me. Why I did that, I don't know. I don't know why. But that was some of the behavior that started at a young age. And he met this lady. Like I said, she had teenagers, and my fascination, I guess, with the hip-hop culture I grew up in or whatnot, I was really fascinated with drugs and alcohol and that lifestyle. The gold chains, the dealing, the cash, whatever comes with it, I was fascinated. And kind of worked out that her daughter was in high school and she was experimenting, I guess you'd say. And in order to get money from my dad and to get the cars to go to, like, Walmart, is what our excuse was, to get frizzies. It's the most expensive hair product at that time, you know, and he'd give her money and we'd ride out to one of the neighborhoods and get stuff. Dry goods are a part of my story, and it builds for a while until alcohol becomes a major problem. That's just how I started out as a millennial, you know. So that's what we did, and you know, I thought it was the most awesome thing. My sister was fairly attractive, and so I fit in with the guys that would jump in the car and ride around with us. They kind of, you know, were really nice to me, and they were older and they were cool, and I felt like I fit in with this crowd. And looking back, they just wanted my sister, so they were nice to me, you know, but I didn't know that then. So I thought everything was good, and I was pretty bad in school. I did my schoolwork in class. I never wanted to do homework. When I got home, I wanted to hit outside. I played in the woods, played basketball, things like that. And I stayed in trouble in school. I think my first run-in was at 11 years old. I was selling some fake stuff at school, and the resource officer caught me. And that was the first flag that my father had that there's some issues going on other than my behavior. You know, I was diagnosed with ADD and given all those medications and things like that for that. But that was the first major thing that got his attention, that something was wrong. I guess he kind of brushed it off, you know. I didn't really hear much about that. My little punishment or whatnot. So I ended up seeing my mom for the first time, probably eighth grade, eighth summer of seventh, going into eighth grade. And something changed in me when I went down to Georgia and seen her for the first time. Things improved. You know, they split schools up. Southern Pines Schools joined with Aberdeen, and I went to Southern for the first year it was open, played football, and I was kind of hanging out with a little bit of better crowd. And I did well. I did really good in school, and then I went to high school. And that's where it really began. I don't really know how I made it the freshman year. I had some kids that I grew up in the neighborhood that were good guys. They were really good students, and you know, involved in like Cub Scouts and things like that, and church and Young Life. And I kind of did stuff with them, but I was always the bad one. I was a couple years younger. I was always bad, and they liked it, and I got cherished for it. You know, it's kind of like, hey, he's so bad, but everybody loves, you know. So I liked that, and it gave me the attention that I craved. They graduated and left, and that's when I really started hanging out with the crowd that was doing what I was doing. And that's when I actually, my days missed were higher than my grades. It's a true story. Resource officer, I had to go down to the school and get searched before I would go to class every day. My book bag had to get looked through and whatnot. I just started experimenting with some alcohol my sophomore year, really getting drunk. I tasted it or whatnot, and I didn't get the effects of it. I didn't drink enough of it. The first time I did get effects of it, I was down at Pine Bluff at a party. And I got there early. This is a trend that really starts here. I got there early to set up. Well, a buddy of mine and his grandmother and mom were setting up, and they were drinking boxed wine. And they were making PJ and stuff like that. So I just started drinking with the parents. And it didn't stop. You know, I ended up, I had three older brothers looking for me that night. I woke up on a crate, throw up on me. It was a heck of a night. And I woke up the next day feeling awful and could not wait to do it again. I was so excited. You know, so excited. Had PJ all down my shirt, had the Kool-Aid lips and all that stuff. But I couldn't wait. You know, I could not wait to do it again. And that started a trend. A buddy of mine's parents went out of town. They went up Lake Tillery every weekend. And his house is a party house. It's out way out near Camp McCall. Way down dirt roads, and we threw down every single weekend. We could not wait to drink down there. And that's what we did. And that started the obsession with alcohol. Also, I got in some legal trouble. First time at 15, I was stealing my dad's cars in the middle of the night and driving all the way to Hope County to get dry goods. And he finally had enough of it, and he called the law on me, and they come arrested me. But I had the keys, so it wasn't a felony. So they had to basically write their little unauthorized use of motor vehicle citation, and they took me and dropped me off at school, and I begged them to drop me off by the auditorium, not right up front, not let everybody see me getting out of a police car. And that was the first run-in. The second run-in was a few months later, and I got two felonies and a misdemeanor for marijuana possession. And, basically, Dad left me in jail for about a week, begging him to come get me out. I told him I'd gotten beaten up, and I was in a cell by myself, too, by the way. You know, they had me in juvenile block, but I told him I'd gotten beaten up and all this, and he still didn't come get me. That really pissed me off. He was trying to teach me a lesson. You know, he did, and he hired a good friend of his that is a great attorney, and when I went in to see him, he just wanted to talk about treatment and baseball, and, you know, I want you to tell me you're going to get me out of this, because I'd seen in all the movies that that's what attorneys do. Well, he did a great job. He really did. I got unsupervised probation, and ended up, when Dad bonded me out, I got more charges. And in the process of this, he found out that I had stole a bunch of money from him and out of his safe. And when he found that out, he'd already bonded me out of jail the second time for the exact same charges that I got the first time. 11 months later, he gave me the option, said, you can go back to jail for these felonies, larceny from me, or you can go to treatment. And being that he was in this community in Alcoholics Anonymous, he knew the people that was running. It used to be Bethesda Link. I think it's called Port now. He knew them very well. And they accepted me. They didn't like to take people from the local community. So I went there reluctantly. I thought my life was over. I'd give all my CDs to everybody. And it was just over. 6 months, life's over, you know. So I went. I didn't think I had a major issue. You know, these kids were in there, and they were addicted to shooting drugs and Xanaxes and doing these crazy stories out here. You know, I had this mentality. I'm a hustler, you know. And anyway, I just kind of faked it through. But luckily, I heard things later on. And one of the things was I heard that acceptance on page 417, and I never forgot that. There was this girl from Chapel Hill, and she was really bad off when she'd come in, really, really sick. And they would call groups when you'd act up, and I constantly had a group called on me because of my behavior. And anyways, and she read that out of that because I just couldn't get along with everybody else. I could not get along with other people. And that stuck with me, even though I didn't want to stay sober. So I ended up getting kicked out of there. It was co-ed. I got kicked out. And I probably tried to do good for a week, maybe. You know, if that, I went right back to what I was doing, and I did get some credits for school, was able to get my license back, so it kind of worked out in my favor, but I didn't want to go back to school, and my dad said, well, there's no reason you should go back to school, because you weren't at school when you went to school. He had found out later on I wasn't going to school, and he had been paying for Huntington Learning Center, get my SATs up, and, you know, so I could get into a good college or whatnot, and I would do that, because he dropped me off and picked me up, but anything else I didn't do. So I went to work for him full time, and this enabled me at 17 years old on a construction site to do what I thought I wanted to do. I could stay out all night and party and go to work, and I could do things on the job that were not supposed to be done, but they were done. And luckily for me, I didn't want to work, but he made me work. I was telling Corey earlier, when I would lay in the bed, laid out drunk all night the night before and lay in the bed, could not. I don't see how people stay out and drink all night and get up and go to work. I wouldn't do it. I would not get out of that bed. You couldn't get. He'd take the water hose in the room and spray me, take the bucket of water from the dogs and put it on me, and I'd get up and beat walls in. And he'd say, you're not going to lay around my house and not work. You're going to get up, and you're going to either get out of here or you're going to work, and you got a job if you want to work. You know, and he'd beg me. You know, I'd have all intentions of not drinking. He'd say, just go smoke some of that stuff with your buddies or something. And just chill, don't drink tonight, son. And I meant it. I'd be like, I'm okay. I want to work. I need to work. Just as soon as I'd get over there, they'd have a cooler full of beer. It was on crack one. And it's like everything else that I've done, you know, I can come to a point and stop. When I drink alcohol, it's just like I can't stop until it's gone. Or it's morning time, and I'm like, what the heck do I do now? I got to be at work in 2 hours. You know, that's just how alcohol did me. And I've, as the time went on, the progression went on, I started losing more and more control over my actions when I drank. And did things that I was very shameful for. And I'd wake up and I'd quit hanging out with this crowd of people because the way I acted, at least for a little while, give them a little break, and hang out with somebody different. Ended up with those charges. I got put on probation for those drug charges and went through all the levels of it. I started supervised. I had a probation officer 26 days. She said she didn't think she was enough for me, so they put me on intense, gave me another one. Went in her office. She told me she was my new mother. And being with my mommy issues, you know how that went over. Yeah, I know that's right. And anyways, so I ended up going to prison. She violated me. I come up with this grand scheme of going into the military when I had these violations on me. I'd already been in jail for 10 days on one violation. Well, I got another one. And I went to see the recruiter, and I was going to get out of trouble. And I did everything. I went to Raleigh, took my meds and all that stuff, and I was going to be 101st Airborne. I was set. You know, I thought this was going to be really cool. You know, I was 19. And I went in front of the judge, and I remember the night before, being that my father was in AA, he taught me to pray the AA way. Ask for God's will. You know, little things like that in my life. And the first time in my life ever that I asked for God's will, I did it at behind the bowling alley in a mobile home park back there, partying one last night with my buddies. Asked for God's will to be done the next day, and I had court. And I went to prison. That pissed me off. I said, there ain't no way this is God's will. No way. You know, screw that. I'll never pray again. I'll definitely never ask for God's will again. That is not happening. Because I didn't like it. You know, I ended up, I had some time served. I think I had to do it in like 5 months. And went to Polk Youth Institution. I was 19, and I rode with the women in the van. By myself. Usually they pick you up in a bus and you got a bunch of other guys. You can kind of pump each other up. Yeah, I wish this guy would get me, you know. I rode with women and they were crying. And I pull up to this huge institution, double barbed wire, and then it's got the dead man's on with the Constantine rolls about 10 feet between fences. And I'm like, what in the world is this? No. You know, I'm in here for weed. Y'all sending me here, but they don't care. If you're a felon, you go where felons go, regardless of what felony it is. So they put me in there. I stayed there for a little while and ended up going to Wake Advancement Center. While I was there, an obsession, you know, I wanted to work out. I wanted to look good when I got out. I really cared about the outside more than anything else. I clicked up with some guys, and now I thought they were old then, but actually they were in their 30s. You know, one of them was like 41. They just were so old. One of them had a bald head and he shaved slick. And they took a liking to me. I was the youngest guy on that unit. And, you know, they took me to church with them. They took me to some AA meetings. In prison, I was still dabbling and dibbling. You know, if you've never been or you've never heard any stories, there's plenty of stuff to do in there if you got money. Don't got money, there ain't a whole lot to do. But if you got money, there's plenty to get yourself into. And of course, my dad was sending me money, and he enabled me as he always did. So I kept. Luckily, 2 weeks before I got out, I was drug screened, and I dipped the cup on them, and I did not get busted. I just barely got away. I had all these great plans. I'd been to college one time before. Probation officer made me get my GED. When I went down to Sand Hills, 17, 18 years old, I was like, oh yeah. I got the sign up here. This is popping. New people, you know. So I got my GED a couple weeks and signed up for business admin. You know, that was my deal. I was going to get a business degree. And I didn't make it a semester. You know, I met more people to drink with. And dad was pretty cool when I was going to school. When I was doing positive things, he really enabled me. You know, I didn't have to work, had gas money, whatnot. So my drinking picked up, and obviously I can't study when I drink. I can't function when I drink. I'm just a slob. So I dropped out. Well, when I got out of prison that time, I had this big, huge plan of I was going to become a marine biologist. Right? I have no idea where I daydreamed this up from, where it even come from, you know. They don't even make that much money, you know. Like, that's not even something I would think about. But I did. And I shot this, run this by my dad. He's like, yeah, I'll support you 100%, son. Whatever you want to do. And I had it all figured out. I was going to go down to Fort Fisher and do my internship and work with the fish and the turtles and all that stuff. I don't know what was wrong with me. Anyways, all I've ever done is construction, you know. But So I didn't make it again a semester. You know, I'd start out great, doing good, you know, and then I would just crash, throwing parties every night and whatnot. So anyways, tried that, went back to doing electrical work for my dad, and I do good for a while, and then I do bad for a while. It's just kind of the merry-go-round. Ended up in 2006, I was 19, my dad relapsed after 22 years of sobriety. He was building a house out in Eastwood. He was engaged to another lady. That first lady he met in Alcoholics Anonymous relapsed, and he divorced her. He hung in there. She was going to shock treatments. It was a real bad situation. And she ended up dying of an overdose some years later, I think in 2006, 2007. But he divorced her, and you know, she was a good lady. She tried everything. She loved me, but she just was sick with this disease, and it was eating her up. And so he had met another lady this time in 2004, 2005. And they were building a house out in Eastwood, a log home. And he was painting the walls. He was trying to do a lot of the stuff himself. Of course, we wired it, but doing everything else too. And he tripped over a 5-gallon bucket of paint. Went to the doctor, and they prescribed him narcotics. And being an alcoholic, it set it off. You know, at that time, his sponsor had passed away, and I don't know, I'm not going to take his inventory, but it went downhill, and I was in the midst of major, I was just out there. I was out there. I was drinking. I was doing everything I could get my hands on. I was just a straight party boy, and I was dabbling with everything illegal, and when he relapsed, he asked me one night. He's going down the stairs. I knew when he relapsed, the doctor cut him off. He went to the methadone clinic, and he was coming down off of that. I was walking down the stairs one night, and he said, come here real quick. I walked in there, and he said, I need you to get me some of those things y'all been talking about around here. And at first, I said no. And I started down the stairs, and then there it went, that manipulative, self-centered alcoholic that I am. I turned around and said, your daddy's got plenty of money, boy. This is what you've always wanted. Get him on your team. And so I turned around and told him, what do you want? And he gave me $600, said, whatever you can get. That was the first drop. So it just skyrocketed from there. Everything went, you know. Luckily, he didn't never drink again. So it would have probably been a very violent home because I was drinking and there was no telling what I would do. I did a lot of terrible things when I drank. And that enabled me basically to do what I wanted. I didn't work anymore. I lived off of him. He supported my habits. So what I did with my money was basically go to the beach, go to college towns, buy stuff for my car, just blew it. And ended up probably a year and a half later, I was out with some buddies one night and we went out drinking and this is how it usually went down. This was a work night. It's like a Thursday night. And a buddy of mine called and said, you want to go get some steak? Outback. I said, yeah, let's do that. So when we get to the restaurant, automatically I order mixed drinks. We're waiting, got our little buzzer. So I start drinking Blue Motorcycles. We get our dinner, I start drinking Heinekens. And for some reason, when I get lit on alcohol, I want to be seen. I want to be out. I don't care if I have to drive, if I have to call. I want to go downtown and party. That's just how I was. I did not want to sit around and drink by myself at that time. And anyways, make a long story short, we ended up at Jefferson Inn. Drinking double shots, Crown and Coke. Left there, they closed at 12 there. Well, Pure Gold's still open, and the guys had a great idea to go there. To make a long story short, I ended up with 4 assaults with a deadly weapon that night, a DWI and drug possession and some other stuff. And I'm just so grateful that there wasn't a weapon in the car. I used the car as a weapon, but there wasn't a firearm or anything like that. There's no telling what I would have done. That slowed my drinking down some. It really did. I was terrified after that bout because I just didn't. It had got to the point where, you know, when I was younger and I was drinking, it'd be maybe 2 or 3 months and then something bad would happen. And then it was kind of like revolve like that. Well, it got to be about every time I drink, every 2 or 3 times I drink, I would show out really, really bad. It was unpredictable what I would do. So that slowed me down, but the other stuff still continued. Ended up in February 2010, we had some issues with the house, and I was staying in a condo in Pinehurst, and the sheriff's department, or 3 different departments, come kick the door in. And they found a lot of narcotics. They charged me with trafficking, pharmacy break-in, firearms, and everything else that goes with it. And they also charged my dad. He, the condo was under his name, and they knew that he knew because they'd been watching me for days, watching traffic, and they got him with traffic by possession as well. I tried to take the blame. He got pissed off later that I said anything to him, but I told him it was all mine. And they didn't charge him with the firearms. They did me. And put us in jail. And when we went to jail, basically, you know, I didn't even have anything to say. When they come, I was almost dead. I was seriously dying. I felt it coming. I knew it was coming. And I remember asking God, please do something. You know, I always kept a lot of guns. And I would take the gun and I'd lay there. My dad would quit breathing at night from the chemicals he's mixing. So I'd babysit him. And if it wasn't for that dog, Ringo, Rottweiler we had, you know, he just, you know how animals will do you. And I just love that dog so much. So anyways, I babysit my dad. And, you know, when he stopped breathing, I looked him off. And it was a miserable time. I'd take that gun and go hide it. Because at nighttime, there's nothing else on but like 48 hours. You know, you watch these murder scenes over and over. My brain was so sick. I was trying to figure out how to, I couldn't shoot myself. I was on probation, so I'd hit all the smaller caliber pistols. I had a 357 that I was carrying. I couldn't figure out how to blow my brains out without him finding half my head gone because of this large caliber gun. I know suicide attempts, if you want to be clean, use a 22, you know. So anyways, there was a lot of that going on. I intervened in him one night. It was basically I was out at Blues Farm partying, and I was sitting there and everything was going well. I hadn't even planned on leaving at a bonfire, and something told me, you need to go home now. And I followed that. I'd been drinking and I drove home, and I intervened in him trying to kill himself. And so that's kind of what was going on at the time in our lives. We're both miserable. Could you know, being a member of Alcoholics Anonymous for all those years, having a great, beautiful life, and then relapsing and it crashing down, you know, that's where he was at. And I was just, I was so out there. I was so lost. I was hurting so much in every single way. So when they locked us up, it was almost like taking a sigh or a breath. It's like, damn, it's over. Excuse my language. It was like, wow, you know, what now, though? You know, I figured 5 or 6 years in prison is what I figured. So we laid in a cell for about a week because we were detoxing so hard. They wouldn't allow us for safety reasons to be in population. Finally, the nurse come in and she said, you know, can you handle yourself? And of course, I always say yes to that, you know, but I really didn't know that was just the first signs, because I'd been on stuff for 5 years and it never went without one time. I didn't know what a withdrawal was. I'd felt hot flashes and things like that, some shakes, but I'd never withdrawn. And so they separated us. They put me in the old jail, put him in the new, where they could keep a better eye on him because he was 59 years old. They took our blood pressure a couple times, give us Phenagrin and anti-diarrheal pills, and let us lay. It took me about 3 months to get my strength back. In the process, I think Dad, he ended up with going to court six months into staying in jail. We didn't bond out. Bonds were high, super high. Had the highest counts of trafficking, heroin, or opiates, and I had conspiracy charges too. He ended up going to court, and when he did, you know, there was a lot of members. There's probably a couple in here tonight that showed up as character witnesses for my dad that were in Alcoholics Anonymous. Nobody else showed up. You know, there's a couple family members, maybe two or three that showed up, and he had a lot of letters, a lot of letters. They ended up granting him 90 to 117 months, which is a level down of trafficking that we were charged with. And he took that plea, and I ended up getting trouble in jail. Like I said, it didn't stop me from acting up just because I got busted. I was wild. I ended up put in lockup for over four months, single cell. And fortunately, they did. If I cleaned my room, my cell, they'd let me come out and take a shower and use the phone. I didn't have my call, so what I did, my dad's cell block was next door. I'd go beat on the door and we could talk. So I kind of liked being in lockup, as sick as that sounds. And then they finally needed that room. What they put in there, they put high-risk inmates in that area I was in. So if you had a murder charge or, you know, something like that, that's where they would put you. They ended up moving me back to a regular felony block, and you know, I lost contact with him. He got sentenced, and he went to Craven, which is a medium custody processing camp, processed there, and then went to Harnett Correction. It's a medium custody medical school camp. I stayed in jail another 5 months. My plea bargain was 225 to 279 months. It's 18 years, 9 months minimum. Because they knew that I was, had hands in dealing and stuff. They found a lot of cash also. And I said, we're going to give them the big sentence. Tried to go to treatment. I knew I needed help. You know, there's no doubt in my mind I needed help. I got accepted. The DA said, no, you're not going. Anyway, so basically as a byproduct of the people showing up for my dad in Alcoholics Anonymous and him getting a lesser sentence, I got the same thing. It took months later, but I did. I got the same thing. The judge ran everything together, and I got 917 months as well. Well, for me, I didn't go to Craven. I went to Central Prison. I was 23. It was a hard time, you know? I was lost. They did have some Alcoholics Anonymous meetings, and I did go to some. I got a big book from there. It was the third edition. It says Central Prison on the side. It had been lost in my travels over the years, but unfortunately, I guess you'd say, I didn't stay sober. I left there and went to a maximum security prison down in Bertino, or in Tabor City. When I got there, I fell right in with the crowd I know to run with. I started getting tattoos and getting my hands on illegal stuff. Stayed there 6 months. I signed up for a construction program because I wanted to get where my dad was. And they shipped me right out of there because they sent me a little thing talking about electrical work and had me fill out basically like an application or find out what I knew, and the questions were very easy. And they snatched me up within a week. So I went to Birdie Correction. This was maximum security, all close custody at the time, but we were housed in Red Unit, which was usually a lockup unit. There were three blocks of us, and there was 150 of us, and we built a prison. Well, we were the guys with cigarettes aren't allowed in prison. We were the guys with the cigarettes. Cigarettes are more valuable than drugs in prison, or alcohol, and we had them. So that enabled me to party hard. I partied 6 months hard. I stayed drunk every day. We did it all. We even had the air, you know, that you pump up air conditioners and stuff for you on and all that stuff. It was crazy. There were no AA meetings there. There was no recovery there whatsoever. They wouldn't allow it. Too bad if things were happening to let people come in. It was an STG camp, which is gang. So ended up getting transferred to Harnett. When I got there, I was glad to see my dad. We were able to sit on the yard together, go to canteen together. We were able to hang out. That's an open yard. The other places I were, you go through one door, they shut this one before they open this one. Well, this place was open. When they opened the yard up, you could just roam. It was huge. And they did. They had really good AA meetings down there. They had sponsors that come in. And my dad had gotten back into Alcoholics Anonymous. He was actually reading with other inmates on the yard. He was going to some other church services. And he was back in, you know, and he was sober. And he was helping other alcoholics to the best of his ability with what was given. And he invited me a couple of times. As soon as I got there, the night I got there, I was blistered. Laying there, didn't know anybody, staring at the ceiling because I was afraid to talk to anybody. But I still did that, you know. And he knew. But finally, you know, out of my manipulation, because I did have money, I had $40 a week that you could spend, and my dad did too. Well, I figured that if I blew mine, I could get the backside of his because he only spent like $15, $20 a week. And his criteria was, you're going to go to an AA meeting once a week with me. So I'm like, okay, well, I'll get your money. You know, that was my thinking. So that just gives me more party money. And down here is a medical camp. It's wide open. All kinds of stuff. And I started going to meetings with him once a week. And, you know, I really can't tell you what I heard in a meeting. When I picked up a few white chips, they give me some service positions. And I was like, whatever, I'll do it. I really want Dad to be happy, so I'll do it. I don't know what I heard, but I know the next day when I seen him, I come up and I asked him, I said, you know, I'm thinking about doing this AA thing. And he lit up. You know, he said, that's great, that's great. He said, I can't sponsor you, son, because you never listen to what I got to say. But I know somebody who would be a good fit, who I think is working this program. I said, all right. So he introduced me to him. And off the bat, the guy, you know, set up a meet date, and we got the book. He was another inmate. This was an inmate. And he actually had a murder charge. He had 21 years that he was serving minimum, and he started taking me through the book Alcoholics Anonymous. He asked me if I could pray. I said, I've been praying every day since I've been in here, and I did. When I hit Central Prayer, well, I was praying in jail, but it's foxhole, like, get me out of this. Something happened. you know, some kind of search warrant wasn't good, something like that, or let's make bond so we can run, something. But I said, yeah, I've been praying for my safety since I've been here. When I hit CP at 23 years old, I was praying for my safety. I was, but I was also prepared to do whatever I had to do to live. And so I said, yeah, I can. And he asked me just simply, ask God to keep me sober and thank him at night. He gave me a daily reflections. He said, read this, meditate on it, think about it, think about how it applies to your life. I said, I can do that. And, you know, the funny thing with me is the day before my sobriety date, I was lit up. When I started working with this guy, even just a miserable amount, the desire to drink or do anything else went away from me. That's my story. That's how it worked for me. It's a blessing. It's like it was removed. But I was still sick. I was crazy. Oh, my God. I was so crazy. So I started going through the book with this guy. And it's funny how automatically things start to change. You know, my views and things, my outlook. And I'm starting to be positive about, okay, even though I still have almost 6 years left at this time. I was like, I can do this, you know. I can have a life. Because I knew, I looked around at these guys and how they act, their mentalities. I'm like, I'm not like them. But I'm here with them, you know. So in some ways, I've committed a crime to, you know, fit me right in with them. And I could blend in like a chameleon, but I didn't want that to be my life. And I knew that if I continued on the path, this was going to be my life. Even if I didn't stay in, it was going to be a revolving door if I didn't die. I knew that, no shadow of a doubt. But I didn't have a solution. I didn't have a way out. Started working the steps. We went through the book. We worked the steps the first time. You know, looking back, I didn't know, after being in sobriety for several years, I didn't really know how thoroughly I did it. So I went back through my step work and looked. I ended up with another sponsor. But I went back and I was blown away at 24 years old the way I did my steps and how thorough I put everything on my four step. Like, just, you know, I did them very thorough the first time. And we did them sitting out behind a building on the yard. Did my fifth step out there. And I was very active in the group. At Harnett, my dad ended up leaving. So I guess he's seen me sober maybe, I don't know, 7 months, something like that. I don't do the math. But he left in January. I ended up leaving in May. I didn't want honor grade. I was in school, in electrical wiring school, had a TA job. I was like, I'm good. I had my workout crew. I'll just stay here. I felt comfortable. Well, I guess God's seen it fit for me to go to honor grade. Riley greened me up. And I put in for Hillsboro, which is in Chapel Hill. And I worried them people to death to get me to Hillsboro, about 2 or 3 case managers. Got my shipping bags, and here I was going to Sanford. Sanford's a work camp. They ain't got no school. They don't hardly have no work release. You know, like that. But when I got there, I said, I'll give it a shot. I'll see what happens. I seen one of my buddies that had been in a long time, and he was a good friend of mine at Harnett. He was there, good character. And so I started, you know, just doing the same thing when I got there. Of course, I lost my sponsor, so started going to meetings there right away, and I wanted to volunteer this time. There were, in my opinion, no inmates really involved in Alcoholics Anonymous like there was down at Harnett. So I was like, well, I need to get an outside sponsor. I'm more available here because I'm in honor grade, and eventually one day I hope to get out of the gate while I'm incarcerated. First guy I asked, he said, nope, can't do it. It hurt my feelings. I was like, really? You know? Like I need a sponsor, man. The next Wednesday night, another guy come in, and I'd heard him speak. He actually knew my father because they were both on the board of directors down at Bethesda. And he come in, and I told him who I was, told him I'd been sober a year, that I really needed a sponsor. And he said, what's your address? Wrote it down. He said, all right. I was like, okay, that's it, you know. Sure enough, a couple days later, I got a letter from him. And we corresponded through the mail for about 20 months. Every time he'd come in, I'd meet him at the gate, and we'd talk and whatnot. And we did some step work through the mail. He wanted to take me back through the steps again, which I thought was great, so he could get to know me. And there were some things that had happened that, you know, I didn't come into Alcoholics Anonymous and become, like, perfect or totally honest. I did some very unrecovery-like things in prison. You know, it is what it is. You know, I had to learn from it, and it's by the grace of God that I didn't go out, you know. There were things that happened that I was involved in that were not good. But as time went on and staying sober and working the program of Alcoholics Anonymous, things changed. It did change. My behavior changed. This guy, after 20 months, he ended up, was able to take me out to meetings in Sanford, which Wallace was talking about, and I was able to go out for about 30 months. They had me chairing meetings, had me speaking. They would get me speakers for the speaker meeting. the whole group would come together and find people because they knew I couldn't reach out. It was an awesome experience. I don't think I would stay sober without that experience and that support of that group. I ended up, got work released. Things worked out good. I didn't get to keep none of my money because I was Department of Revenue so much. So I got out of prison. Two Alcoholics Anonymous members were in the parking lot to pick me up. My sponsor, who's my current sponsor today, another fellow, it's been sober almost 30 years in Sanford, picked me up, took me down to Bethesda. They got me in Bethesda, and I was scared, you know. I was like, this is new to me. I had two shipping bags, which are little white bags, and I was lucky to know some people down there, though. There's a lot of people, friends of mine that I used to run with that had gotten sober and were in Alcoholics Anonymous, very involved. They knew a lot of people, and automatically they took me in. I was able to find a job doing electrical work after about 2 weeks. God gave me a chance. I started all the way at the bottom. But I was grateful to have a job. And so I stayed at Bethesda for 9 months. Ended up joining this home group, went to a lot of meetings, and ended up, I moved out of there, a roommate with a good buddy of mine, been my friend for years, and things are getting better. You know, it's a struggle sometimes. You know, I had to start over at 5.5 years sobriety in my life. You know, it's you know, you sit around, you hear people 3 or 4 years sometimes, it's like, damn, well, it's good, you know, but I had to start over, and it's been very humbling. It has. It's been a very humbling experience, and it's a struggle sometimes. I get frustrated, you know. Things aren't going my way. They're not coming together like I think they should or whatnot. And, you know, my sponsor, he loves to throw that time thing on me, things I must earn. He loves that, and it pisses me off. You know, I don't like to hear it, but it's the truth. You know, it's the truth. I did things in my life that I pay consequences for. You know, I'm still paying the Department of Corrections every week, or Department of whatever they call it, Department of Revenue. It's like the IRS with the state. I pay them every week. That's part of my amends to them. Even though it's a little reluctant, I'm not happy to give them that money. I can't say I am. That would be dishonest. But they get it. They get it, you know. And when it's done, I will be happy. I know I will be happy when it's paid. But I talk to my sponsor every day. I still do the things that I did in the beginning. I still read and pray. I have sponsored guys. I sponsored guys in prison. Actually, that meeting that I was a part of for 50-some months, Wallace got started. And very grateful that it was there for me when I come through. That's a byproduct of why I'm here today. And we thought that one meeting a week was not enough. What happened? I heard you talking about it earlier, a guy that couldn't read. And I had a sponsee that couldn't read and started reading in the big book. Well, I had this other sponsee. He was a little needy. And I think he was jealous that I was spending time with this guy, so he'd come sit in while I'd read him the big book. And that kind of multiplied. Other people wanted to join. And it got so big that we couldn't do it in the dorm without affecting other people, and we wanted our privacy, so we went out to the yard. And ended up, sometimes we'd have 10 or 12 people on the yard at an AA meeting on the weekends. And as far as I know, that still kind of is going on since I left. It's kind of hit or miss now, but it revolves. The program's strong sometimes in prison, sometimes it's not. It just depends on the people that are coming and going. But I did get to work with a lot of guys, and I think that's what kept me sane for all those years was Alcoholics Anonymous. You know, I started doing physical exercise. Great sponsor. My mom was supportive. She supported me. We got close while I was in prison. We had never been close. You know, of course, when she moved back to North Carolina in 2009, I was wide open, and I did not want to be around nobody like that didn't know. So we're pretty close. Now we text every night, and I see her when I can see her. I did write some amends letters. My father did pass away in prison. He died while he was in prison down at Hoke. I usually don't tell it, but I come out, so. Because I get emotional about it, but basically his whole side of the family passed while I was in, and he was still in prison at Hope, got diagnosed with cancer and passed away about a year and a half before we were supposed to get out. I was able to make amends to him. I was able to make amends to my grandmother before she passed. And my aunt passed before I was sober, but I did attempt at that time to do the best I could, not being a sober member of Alcoholics Anonymous, to make amends. And tried with my mom. You know how moms are. Oh, goodness. Those amends are something else. They don't want to hear it. You know, can't do any wrong type deal, but it's all your dad's fault. But anyway, you know, all my financial amends have not been made yet. I haven't been in a position to be able to do that. I do owe some of those still. But, you know, for the most part, I did the ones that were closest to me, my family, and we're all good these days, you know. So I still talk to my sponsor every day. I don't know if I said that, just about every day. I'll skip sometimes, but I still talk to him. He is a trip. He is a myth. But, and he, you know, I picked somebody that, for me, had long-term sobriety that was really grounded in Alcoholics Anonymous. I'm a knucklehead. You know, I don't think me clicking up with somebody my age sponsoring me would have been a good fit for me, because I would have probably took us both in the ditch. So I picked somebody that was very grounded, had a lot of knowledge of Alcoholics Anonymous, had been around, does a lot of service, and will call me on my stuff. You know, if he hurts my feelings a lot of times. He don't tell me what to do, but he lets me know what he thinks about my actions. And sometimes I've done things and I've had to call him and tell him, and God, it's so embarrassing. You know, I'd rather stand in front of the judge than stand and tell my sponsor some things that I have done, even as a sober member of Alcoholics Anonymous. That's very humbling. And it definitely makes you not want to do it again, because you're like, damn, I got to tell him this again. Oh, no. So, you know, that has been a major benefit to my recovery, a great sponsor. I'm sure he's sitting by the phone right now waiting on me to call him, Wallace. You know, I just keep coming back. I'm trying to find balance in my life. You know, I talked to somebody, a lady, Bonnie, that's been in this program for a long time. And as a kid, she was one of my therapists. And she said, Mike, you need balance. You're an extremist. You're either one extreme or the other. You need to find a balance. And I'm trying to do that to the best I can today with everything, with relationships, with Alcoholics Anonymous, with working out. I am an extremist. This is one way or the other. And I'm trying to find that balance. And with the help of a sponsor and prayer, you know, it's coming together. It is. A relationship with God, I always want to say that, you know, it has grown. It didn't start out strong. It took me 5 years of sobriety before I go back to church. You know, I didn't want that correction of living. I'll do this the AA way. And you know, but as times went on, I have gone back to my childhood beliefs. And it's a growing thing. Some days I do better with my relationship with God, and some days I don't. You know, some days I feel super spiritual and some days I don't. I asked my sponsor, I said, why is it, am I a bad member of Alcoholics Anonymous? Because some days I don't want nobody to mess with me. That's putting it polite. And some days I'm just as spiritual as I can be. And, you know, he told me the most simple thing, and this was going in the gated prison. He said, you know, those days where you don't want nobody to mess with you, you just don't drink. In the days where you feel spiritual, you just help everybody that you can help, because that's, you're human. And I needed to hear that. That was a breaking point. I needed to hear that. You are human. You're going to make mistakes, Mike. Things are going to happen. You're not going to feel good every day. You know, because some reason in my mind, thinking I'm a member of Alcoholics Anonymous, I should have like this euphoria that I'm perfect. I don't know why. Or that I don't make mistakes. Or if I do, I can't let anybody find out, because, you know, I'm supposed to be this member of Alcoholics Anonymous. But the reality is this a journey? It's a learning process. I keep coming back, learning, and trying to build a relationship with God. But thank you, guys. I'm done.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you so much. That was awesome. We practice the seventh tradition and are self-supporting. Money is used to pay the group's contribution for use of the church and other expenses. We also contribute quarterly to District 52, Area 51, Sand Hills Intergroup, and the General Services Office, which are our local, state, and national service organizations for Alcoholics Anonymous.